Today's discussion is going to focus on software referral partners, which isn't something that you usually think of when you're talking about referral partners. Software developers, application developers aren't the type of people that come to mind when you're thinking about referral partners. But because of the transition that we're seeing from hardware to software, it gets stronger every day. And so everything becomes software-based, which makes software and developers much more relevant in our space when we're selling technology. We talked a little bit about integrations on our last call about contact center experiments, talked about Zapier, talked about all these different systems. But ultimately, because of the world that we live in and because of the software emphasis that all of the technology that we have, integrations and APIs and software developers are so much more important, which makes them much more relevant as a referral partner than they ever have been, and probably one of the most important referral partners that we can have in the mix. There's another reason why we like to work with software developers, because what we found is that it's much more effective to work with people that are impacted by the technology rather than the people that actually write the checks. And this is what we call an inside referral, or an internal cheerleader or advocate. And so working with software developers, their solutions work better when they talk to other applications. They become more relevant, there's more value in them, and they can do a lot more. And so we can't do our job without them, but they can't do their job without us. And so it's great for us to work with and to have relationships with software developers, because if their application that they're developing works better because of the API integrations that we can offer them through technology, like what we talked about on our last call, then we provide value to each other. And that's the ultimate definition of a good referral relationship. It's a one-way relationship rather than a two-way relationship, because we're working together on a single solution. But also what this does is it generates social engineering or social peer pressure, because when you recommend your solution to a company, it doesn't have as much weight when the software developer says, look, I would like to work with this company because we can do this and we can accomplish this. Their recommendations go much further than your recommendations, and that's why we want to get these inside referrals. So what we're going to talk about today is how to get them to become our cheerleaders, because that would certainly make our sales job a lot easier. Now, there's going to be two types of software developers that we're going to talk about today. The first of which is a company, which if any of you have a lead exchange, which all of you should have, you can go to leadexchange.org to set up your own group. But it's highly effective to have a group like this in place. You can refer back to a few of our calls that we've done about lead exchanges. But essentially, every lead exchange should have a software development company. And this is a company that's fully dedicated to doing software development. There's a few IT companies that have a software development arm, which may also be a good fit for you as well. But the reason why is because if you're going to be doing software projects, a lot of times the companies that you're working with don't have enough time or resources to implement that, or maybe they're not as familiar with it. But the main reason why you want to work with a dedicated software company is because if you're implementing some type of integration with your technology solution and someone isn't familiar with it, it's like going to Vegas and gambling and hoping that it works, or that you're going to have to go through several iterations. You don't want to hold up any projects because of any type of integrations and headaches that may take place there. So by having a dedicated company that's familiar with integrations, working with the different platforms, it would certainly make the implementation of your technology a lot more seamless and a lot less hiccups in the process. And likewise, when they're working on projects, they can bring you in on deals because they're familiar with how to work with you and what the value that you provide. And so, because as we talked about in the beginning, all the technology that we sell has some type of software element built into it, whatever it may be, whether it's reporting, whether it's screen pops, whether it's stats, all of these different elements should be able to talk to each other. This helps it makes it their solution more sticky and makes our solution more sticky. And so having somebody on your team that understands your solution and someone that you can turn to and work with, the clients that you're working with, someone that you can trust, will certainly add a lot more value to what you're doing. But especially within the software space, we're trying to differentiate ourselves, which is so difficult, right? Because of that transition to software, a lot of things have become commoditized. And so it's hard to know what's the difference. But when you can add that custom element of a software developer, it makes it so much easier for you to create a monopoly for yourself, making it much more effective to differentiate yourself with clients other than just price. Now, the other type of software developer that we're going to work with primarily are the actual dedicated employees, because that's the common scenario that you're going to be working with most of your clients. There's going to be some type of team or individual who manages the software development for a company. And there's three elements that we're going to use to help engage with them and also help them become that internal cheerleader that we need them to be for your technology solutions. It's been a while since we've talked about this, but there's a specific strategy known as the job security savings accounts. And what this does is, rather than offering someone a referral override for any business that they send your way, you offer them what we call a job security savings account. What this does is it allows you to maintain ethics, because oftentimes it's hard to pay somebody an override for a referral for sending you business. And so it's frowned upon, but it's also less effective. Because what the job security savings account does is it sets aside money from a referral that they send you, and that money stays in that account until they need it. So if they lose their job or if they transition, then at that point you can offer them that money. And so what it does is it creates a safety net for them. And so this is more effective because you're offering them something different, something that they can actually use in the future. Maybe they even come to work for you. But this job security savings account creates a long-term relationship, a long-term type of value that you can provide these software developers. Because like sales, software developers are also one of the most high turnover rate, have one of the highest turnover rates in companies, because it's also somewhat commoditized. Now, the second element to this strategy, we're going to use what we call a bi-monthly local sales job report. It's a version of a sideways sales letter, which we've talked about in the past. But as with anything, we need to create a cadence. And anybody can email anybody on a regular basis, as long as they haven't opted out, of course. But very few people can actually maintain the mind share of their audience. And so in order to make sure that we stay in contact but also maintain mind share, what we're going to do is we're going to put together a local job report of just everything that we're seeing in the local market for software development. And so we'll summarize that and let them know if they have any recommendations or if they're interested in these jobs. We're just providing this report on a regular basis to help them stay up to speed as far as what's happening in their local market. And what this does is it allows us to create a cadence to make sure that we maintain that mind share, so when that next project comes up, they can think of you and not forget about the types of services that you offer. The third element that works really well here is what we call the opinion sales strategy. And what this does is it caters to their ego. And this is another valuable method of staying in contact with companies. So what this does is, if you have a software question or something that's beyond your abilities to understand or to grasp, or if you're talking to somebody and you just don't know you're looking for a recommendation or whatever it may be, you would then reach out to any of these software companies and ask for their opinion about something related to their field. And now a lot of times we think, well, we don't want to bug them, but you're not bugging them. You're offering them, you're feeding their ego, because you're asking something that they know a lot about, and they're going to feel good about answering that. And so it's good. Obviously you're not going to ask them every day, but every month or so, if there's something that comes up, you can ask about their opinion about something that they would know, and it helps you build a relationship with them. Now, looking at these three elements, you're probably wondering, well, how am I going to get a sales out of this? There's not, obviously, maintaining contact does help, but we need something more. And so every once in a while, probably once every 2 months, you want to send them an email that looks something like this. And so this is where they're going to be able to make sure that they understand what you do. And you can change the content of this slightly based off of maybe new integrations, new capabilities. But you want to make sure that you send something that speaks to them. And so if the only way you're going to work with software reps, if you have a vendor that you work with, or if your company offers some type of API. And so if you want to speak their language and catch their interest, send them your API docs. And so once they look it over, it'll be something that'll start generating ideas for them. So when they're working on projects, they can say, you know what, I saw this API doc that does this, this, and this. I think this would work for what we're trying to do. And so helping them become familiar with what you do would help them ultimately become that internal cheerleader that you're looking for. So as you're maintaining contact with the software development reps through email cadences and through questions, every once in a while you'll say, hey, I have this API doc, just wanted to share it with you in case you have any projects that we can help you with. So this is a template that we put together here. It says, I wanted to share with you our API documentation. See attached. You can also link it, but I like to attach it. If you think of any scenarios where we can help you connect your software to phone records and phone stats, and this is where you can modify it a little bit with different scenarios, please let me know. We have a job savings account for your referrals. The details here, and then you can link it to like your referral program and how it works and how you would be able to help them. And just kind of leave it at that. And so every once in a while, just change it up a little bit, talk about how you can help them using the integration systems and APIs that you have in place. We have a great platform here to help you find developers in any given market. If you go to unsable.com/data, just go to the contact preferences section, and you'll notice there's you can select programmer as the function, and then you can layer any other elements on top of that. So if you're focusing on a lit building list, you can do it specifically to pull all the programmers out of a lit building list. Or if you just want to do it based off of a zip code or a specific type of technology, maybe you integrate well with Salesforce. And so you can pull all of the programmers who work for companies who use Salesforce for their CRM. And so there's lots of different ways to layer it on. If you ever get stuck, just hit the chat us button in the bottom right hand corner, and our team members will be more than happy to walk you through that. But this, again, this is a lot, makes it really easy to create that core list of developers. You know, pull 300 or 400 developers in your local market, create the cadence. You will have a few that will opt out, but hopefully a few hundred will stick around, and you can stay in contact with them on a regular basis. The next time they have a project that may require an integration with your technology, they're going to turn to you first because they're familiar with the solution. You're adding value to your relationship with them. You're asking them questions, and you're building that relationship, which will ultimately help them have the confidence to work with you. But ultimately, what we want them to do is we want them to be the people that are selling the solution to you, to the IT manager, rather than yourself, because they have more influence than you would because of their position at that company. That's ultimately why we're working with software developers, because everything we work with is software-based. So that's everything for today. Hopefully that was helpful. On our next call 2 weeks from today, we're going to be talking about virtual sales forces and how to create that, how to leverage that. But until then, I hope everyone has a great weekend, a great 2 weeks, and we'll be talking to you soon. Thanks, everyone. Take care.